Morning everybody, and welcome to our online service for the 25th of October. In my hand I have something precious to me. It's a chalice that was given to me at my ordination in 1999. On it is a symbol of a fish and the inscription IHS. In his service. Over my shoulder is Vindolanda, and I've come to Vindolanda today to see an important piece of archaeology which was found here this year. It's a Christian chalice made out of lead. It's in 14 fragments and we believe it's in the shape of a cereal bowl. Both inside and outside the chalice is inscribed Christian pictures and symbols. There is a fish which has always represented Christ in Christianity. There is the letters Chi and Rho, which are the first two letters, Chi and Rho, in the Greek of Christ's name. There is a picture of a whale which reminds us of the Old Testament and the story of Jonah. There is a picture of a group of people together which represents a church family. There is a picture of a laughing bishop inscribed on the chalice. And all the Roman letters and Greek symbols. It's a reminder of the importance of the Christian community here in the 6th century, where they have been doing an archaeological dig on a church. And it's the focal point in one of the rooms of the museum which I've been to today. As a Methodist minister, I was called to both the word and the sacrament. And so to see such an artifact today has been important to me in this time of lockdown. It's something that's certainly worth coming to see. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for today, Bible Sunday, when we can open your word and share together your truths. We pray, Father God, that you will journey with us through this time of worship. May it be a special time when we can reach out to you. May your word bless us and increase in us our capacity to serve you. We ask these things in the precious name of Christ, our Lord and our Redeemer. Amen. I want to thank Kathy and Tim for leading us in our worship today, and also Wendy and Lynn from Head of Methodist Church, who will be reading the scriptures. I pray that you will enjoy the service and enjoy these words which describe the Word of God. Your word is like honey to my lips. Our first hymn. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Enjoy the service.
To love. Nehemiah chapter 8. Ezra reads the law. When the seventh month came, and the Israelites had settled in their towns, all the people assembled as one man in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon, as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand, and all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him on his right stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. And on his left were Pedaiah, Mishael, Malkiah, Hashum, Habadashanana, Zechariah, and Meshulam. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Yeshua, Bani, Sherebana, Yabin, Akub, Shebatai, Hodiah, Messiah, Kalita, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, and Peliah, instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites, who were instructing the people, said to them all, "This day is sacred to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep," for all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some of those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." The Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be still, for this is a sacred day. Do not grieve." Amen.
Thank you, Wendy, for reading the Nehemiah passage for us, especially the names of Nehemiah's co-workers. Well done. We now come to our prayers of adoration and confession. Let us pray. God of love and grace, beyond our telling, we bring our thankful hearts to you, acknowledging that without you we are nothing and with you can be so much more. Thankful that you care for us and love us beyond measure, that you have endless patience with us, that you teach us time and time again what it is to be committed to you and your way. Thank you that you reveal yourself to us in a myriad of ways to inspire us and revoke within us a heartfelt response. With overflowing hearts, we gather in this place, wherever we are, to worship and be changed. Forgiving God, more willing to forgive than we are to confess, help us to see our failings, to see where we fall short, to see where we deceive ourselves, where we close our eyes and ears and do wrong. May we breathe in the reality of our actions and the need to change, the depth of our unworthiness. We come before you now, seeking forgiveness. Now let us breathe in the power of your forgiveness and breathe out the need to live and love, that we may forgive as you have forgiven us. Amen. To further reading now from the New Testament, from Paul's letter to the church at Colossae and Matthew's Gospel, both to be read by Lynn from Hedden Chapel. And sandwiched between, Reverend Tim Woolley will lead us in our second hymn, Good, Good Father.
Colossians chapter 3. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I see many searching for answers, far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Always love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so inexplainable eye. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love.
Matthew chapter 24. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs become tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see all these things, you know that it is near, right at the door. Truly I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Amen.
Text today is taken from the Psalms. Your word is a lamp to my feet, a light on my path. I wonder how often those words have meant so much to people. So let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. All for Jesus. Have you ever said to someone, "Can I have a word?" Has someone ever come to you and said, "I need a word"? Have you ever made the assertion someone was going to get a piece of your mind? When in trouble, have you ever been asked, "What have you got to say for yourself?" Have you ever been called a loudmouth? Have you ever used a four-letter word? Have you ever been lost for words or found yourself totally speechless? Does action really speak louder than words? Or is silence really golden? Whoever we are, the spoken and the written word has and will continue to have an impact on our lives every day. in the midst of the melee of words that come our way, trying to break in and embroider itself across our day, and indeed across our lives, is the Word of God. What does that Word of God mean to me? What does that Word of God mean to you? Is it life-changing, life-giving, and life-shaping? The psalmist wrote, as we heard earlier, "The Word of God is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." In Psalm 18, the writer describes God's Word as flawless. Isaiah reminds us that even though the grass withers and flowers fall, God's Word endures forever. In rebuking the devil, Jesus quotes scripture himself and says, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." And John begins his gospel with these words: "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." The list goes on, and I'm sure most of you could add to it. Today is Bible Sunday, and the readings chosen today and read by Wendy and Lynn were all about God's Word and its implications for the lives of God's people. I recall a story of the influence of a young 9-year-old Welsh girl in the late 1790s. Her name was Mary Jones. Mary attended a small chapel in Snowdonia and was fascinated by the Bible stories being taught to her, and especially that these stories were in her own language. More than anything, Mary wanted to and longed for a Bible of her own. So much so, Mary saved up for 5 long years. It was a rare thing for anyone to own their own Bible in her day. Mary, aged just 15, walked 25 miles across the mountains to pick it up from a priest in the village of Barla. The priest was so impressed, he told the story in London, and within 5 years the British and Foreign Bible Society was formed to make the Bible in the vernacular available to people all over the world. Today the Bible has been translated into over 3,000 languages and dialects, including an increasing number of sign languages. This includes complete New Testament and Old Testament volumes in over 2,000 languages. In our reading from Nehemiah, we see the people build a raised wooden platform for the priest Ezra and others to speak and teach from. I can't really see that catching on, can you? Ezra then reads to the people, explaining its meaning and the significance for everyday life. It's life-changing as people hear and are given understanding, so much so people begin to weep. I remember some years ago driving to York with a group of youngsters from Manchester in order for them to experience the ministry of St. Michael the Belfry Church. The faith community there had been built up and led by the late David Watson. We were sat in the balcony where we thought they'd be safe. After the word in season was preached and an altar call was made, all 15 teenagers clambered out of that balcony and ran down the stairs to commit their lives to Christ, all of them, for the first time. A few weeks later, the parents of one of the girls turned up at a youth event and asked if they could stay. When they asked why, they said they wanted what their daughter now had. They wanted to change for Christ the same way he had amazingly changed their wonderful daughter. In our epistle today, we see Paul pray for the Colossian church, and he encourages them to let the word of Christ dwell in you richly and to live the thankful life. In the gospel reading, Jesus makes a serious claim for his words. Although the world is to pass away, his words will not. It is a troubling chapter with prophecies of fear and suffering, a time in which certainties will be swept away, a time in which we will fear for our safety, a time of judgment, a time when securities will be swept away and chaos will ensue. Does it sound familiar? But remember this. In the midst of all that chaos, whatever comes, Jesus reassures us that we can rely on him and that his words will always remain. What might the word of God mean to us today? Do we allow it to call us, change us, equip us, unite us, feed us, and build us up? Three areas that I would like to share with you. The first one is bringing the word to those who have not heard it. We saw this demonstrated beautifully in the reading from the Old Testament and the work of Nehemiah. In chapter 1, we see him weeping because of the state of the nation and the plight of Jerusalem as a city. It leads him to fast and pray as he receives his mandate from God. Despite massive opposition to his work, we read the repair to Jerusalem's walls and gates is completed in a mere 52 days. He then begins the real task of rebuilding Israel as a nation and restoring its spiritual and national life. It was a work he dedicated himself to for over 12 years. And the book of Nehemiah demonstrates a life commissioned with a mandate and a message from God. He committed all he had to restorative action towards his bewildered people, a broken generation living in exile. Through prayer and fasting, God helps him to raise up spiritual leaders who pray as well as teach, intercessors, gap people, as they were come to be known, who were rooted in God. In verses 8 to 12, we read these words. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing people said to them all, "This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The Levites calmed all the people, saying, Then all the people went away to eat and drink, to send portions of food and to celebrate with great joy, because now they understood the words that had been known to them. It wasn't just a case of just reading God's word, but bringing teaching and understanding, gathering them all together in one place, recognizing the time together as holy, allowing the word of God to impact on daily life, remembering the poor and others who could not be there, sharing the feast, allowing God's joy to embrace and influence all flowing from God's word. And my second point is building a community under the Lordship of Christ. In the first chapter of Colossians, Paul shares an amazing piece of testimony in verse 25. He says, I became a minister according to the stewardship of God, which was given to me to fulfill the word of God. Not at all what Paul expected, to be building a community under the Lordship of Christ. He was the persecutor of the early church, committing his life to destroy it. And yet here he is now building for Christ. Just like Nehemiah, he arrives with a mandate for his generation to preach Christ and to work as an ambassador to the Gentiles. It's to the community at Colossae, a small town in the province of Asia, that Paul teaches about the kind of people we are to become. Elect of God. Chosen, if you like. I love that. Holy and beloved. Putting on what he describes as tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long suffering, bearing with one another, forgiving. But then he says, but above all, he says to put on love, to wear it like a garment. And he describes this as the bond of perfection. This is the type of community we have to strive to be, even in lockdown. We are to fulfill God's mandate for our own lives and serve our own generation. Be everything our community needs, living the Christian life that demonstrates what Paul describes in verse 16 as letting the word of Christ dwell richly. I love that. People seeing his Christ and Christ alone. And then my final point is building a way of life. I want to encourage you to read one of the Gospels right through. It is a proclamation of the Word of God. Good news for all of life's situation. Perhaps it would be good to read one that's less familiar to you. it is a word from God. It tells us that the world has a saviour, a leader, a Lord. It is the foundation of faith and fellowship. No matter how fast the world is changing, the word of God is our unshakable foothold and will not pass away. The words of Christ stand forever. Its values endure. I want to finish today with a word on joy. For this, I return to the reading we had from Nehemiah, and the joy he speaks about at the end of the passage I read earlier. He speaks about people sharing. We need joy. We might even be longing for it right now. On Sunday last, I was speaking to Steve Phillipson on Zoom at the end of the service at Heddon. He turned his laptop around so I could see a young worshipper who initially came to Heddon Chapel last year to do the Alpha course on the advice of her young daughter who saw our advert. I could see the joy in her eyes, even though she was wearing a mask. I could see what being in fellowship meant to her. And it was wonderful just to share a few words. I was taught some time ago that the joy we experience in fellowship is like a harvest. It is nurtured on warm, radiant fellowship. It is nourished and thrives on creative, constructive work. And it thrives on sustaining triumphant faith. Are we ready to bring the word of God to those who have not heard it, bringing understanding and serving in faith? Can we bring restoration to our communities, building under the Lordship of Christ, adopting a way of life where the Word of God is our unshakable foothold and where joy thrives in triumphant faith? I hope we can. And I hope you do too. God bless you as you journey on in God's word. And dear friends, stay safe. Amen. We come now to our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Since we are promised that Christ will return, let us pray in hope and expectation. Let us bring to his healing and love the needs of the church and the world. Come, Lord Jesus, live in us now. We pray for all Christian people, for an increased love and commitment, working within the world as yeast within the dough. Come, Lord Jesus, live in us now. We pray for those in authority, that they may base their priorities and decisions on the foundations of God's power, justice and mercy. Come, Lord Jesus, live in us now. We pray for those who suffer, for God's strength and support during pain, grief, or distress, so their very suffering may become a channel for God's redeeming love. Come, Lord Jesus, live in us now. We pray for the local community, that God's presence may be known in the varied, separate lives surrounding us, that alerted to their needs, we may work in Christ to care and provide. Come, Lord Jesus, live in us now. In the silence of God's stillness, we name any we know who especially need our prayer at this time. Come, Lord Jesus, live in us now. Lord Jesus, you come to show us the true way to life. Help us to progress along that way in your strength and for your sake. Amen. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is sung by Kathy and is "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." Enjoy the hymn and have a safe and word-filled week. Amen.
What a privilege to come.
And now our closing benediction. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with us, wherever he may send us. May he guide us through the wilderness, protect us through the storm. May he bring us home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown us. May he bring us home rejoicing once again into our doors. Thank you for joining us today for our online service, and God bless you all. Amen.